In this video, I will be giving evidence why hierarchical organizations are not only more preferable to horizontal or egalitarian organizational structures, but are inevitable even if the intention is to create a more egalitarian or horizontal organizational structure. In this portion of the video, I'll be drawing heavily from Organizational Preferences and Their Consequences by Deborah H. Grunfeld and Lazara Z. Titans. In it, they show from a data from across a wide variety of disciplines why hierarchical organizations are not only preferable for human interaction, but are inevitable even when the attempt is to create specifically a non-hierarchical organizational structure. So let me go ahead and read from the abstract. The following passage comes from the textbook Handbook for Social Psychology, Chapter 33, Organizational Preferences and Their Consequences. As automatically as individuals feel, think, and behave, groups of individuals organize, and like other species, humans organize for predictable reasons, in predictable patterns, and with predictable consequences. The study of human organizing behavior occurs across a variety of social disciplines, including social psychology, sociology, biology, and economics, and is central to the interdisciplinary field of organizational behavior. One claim is that among the ways people can organize themselves, certain structural forms tend to dominate organizational life, for better or for worse, because they serve basic human needs. A second claim is that these preferred social structures are intentionally and unintentionally created and recreated by organization members independent of and often in opposition to the formal organization designs that are imposed for strategic purposes. To substantiate these claims about social structure of organizations, this review draws upon literature that illustrate which types of structures dominate organization life and the social, psychological, and organizational processes that facilitate their construction and reconstruction. The drive to organize stems from both evolutionary and existential logics. From an evolutionary stance, living and working in groups and organizations is more adaptive for survival than social isolation. Existentially, human psychology has evolved to reinforce these adaptive arrangements. Human beings are plagued by a fundamental fear of death, which expresses itself in the fear of being alone and in the crisis of meaning. From these anxieties arise basic human strivings for affliction and belonging on one hand, and for impact on the other. People look to organizations to fulfill these strivings, some would say, naively. Indeed, it has been argued elsewhere that among the functions of work is to provide fulfillment of psychological needs, including the ability to establish and maintain social connections with others, to establish, develop, or change one's identity, to acquire status and recognition, and to drive meaning by having impact in the world. It is our claim that certain types of organizations serve these purposes better than others, and these types of organizations should arise more frequently and with greater resiliency than other types of organizations. Specifically, we posit that homogeneous and hierarchical organizations are more psychologically preferable to organizations that are more heterogeneous and egalitarian because they provide a better context for achieving belongingness and impact goals. Organizations naturally gravitate towards social homogeneity and social hierarchy because members conspire, often without awareness, to homogenize and stratify the social environment, even despite and sometimes in reaction to moral, ideological, and strategic imperatives to do the opposite, that is, to embrace and promote more diversity and greater equality. The homogenization of organizations is well documented from a variety of perspectives within sociology and organizational behavior, as well as social organizational psychology. The stratification of organizations into hierarchically ordered groups and individuals is also well documented, but not as evenly across disciplines. Within social organizational psychology, for example, programmatic research on status, power, and social hierarchy is a relatively recent development, although studies to obedience and authority, and of prisoner and guard roles in the Stanford Prison Experiment, for example, are viewed as seminal in the field. In fact, much of the recent social psychological work on stratifying processes have been published within the last 10 to 15 years. Within sociology and organizational behavior, however, analysis of social and organizational stratifications has a longer and more complex history. All right, we're going to be skipping a little bit to hierarchy in this chapter. Previous sections of this chapter reviewed the evidence that people prefer homogeneity, that preference expresses itself both behaviorally, i.e. people enjoy it when they are exposed to it, and verbally, people say that they like being with similar others. There is, of course, some voiced ambivalence about the preference for homogeneity in a political climate that devalues diversity. However, a preference for hierarchy comes with even more ambivalence in the modern American context, which hierarchy is seen as morally corrupt. Thus, the preference for hierarchy is rarely acknowledged or articulated, and the assertion that hierarchy is preferable to more egalitarian structures is almost certainly controversial. An explicit distaste for hierarchy and appreciation for equality can be found in nearly every study of values. In one, representative samples from 13 countries were asked to rate to the extent which 10 values represented important and guiding principles in their lives. Universalism includes a concern for equality and social justice, was third highest ranking across all settings, whereas tradition and power, the values most related to hierarchy, were 8th and 10th, respectively. Similarly, managers from all over the world report that they desire less hierarchy in the workplace than they currently have. And when groups are given a choice about the decision rules, members report a preference for complying with the majority opinion over having individual leader make the decision. Further, when a non-student sample of happily married couples was asked what produced their success, 51% of them gave the response that was coded as equity. Other evidence comes from a study of the founders of new technology firms. When asked about their preference and ideas for new organizations, many founders stated that they wanted equality and participation and sought out structures and practices they believed would support those goals. Certainly, there are contexts in which people are more welcoming of hierarchy. For example, such research suggests that people in Asia have more positive associations with hierarchy than Americans do. There are also individual differences in comfort with preference for inequality. Some people, especially those at the top of hierarchies, desire hierarchies more than others. Groups performing poorly tend to seek greater hierarchy, and the presence of experts and stars, task difficulty, and time pressure all increase stated preference for hierarchical systems. Further, the extent to which hierarchy is avoided versus preferred depends on the rules by which hierarchy operate. Although Americans generally report that they oppose hierarchy, they typically embrace meritocracies in which people are rewarded in line with their efforts and contributions. Meritocracies are clearly hierarchical, yet the notions that differences in power and status are deserved makes them more palatable, even to some who think of themselves as hostile to inequality. Despite the fact that people often do not acknowledge a preference for hierarchy, such a preference can be inferred from the behavioral patterns and from evolutionary and existential logics. The strongest piece of evidence is simply the regularity to which this form of organization is produced. As with homogeneity, people create hierarchies in all types of organizations. When scholars attempt to find an organization that is not characterized by hierarchy, they cannot. When an organization touts itself as truly egalitarian, it garners much attention from the press, in which itself is a signal of its rarity. So, some companies such as IDEO and Gore Incorporated promote their egalitarian ways, as do other types of organizations, such as the chamber orchestra Orpheus, whose primary claim to fame is that it functions without a conductor. However, closer investigations of these organizations show that, though they have rid themselves of the usual trappings of hierarchy, many hierarchical patterns remain. For example, The product design firm IDEO looks egalitarian from the perspective from formal positions. There are more than 150 employees, and yet almost everyone carries the formal title of engineer. Yet firsthand observations of brainstorming sessions reveal that the engineers compete for respect and status at face-to-face meetings. Engineers acquire status based on their respective abilities to come up with quote-unquote cool ideas and the brainstorming sessions. Status is doled out in the form of compliments, neat, wow, or cool. By pursuit of one person's idea by others and invitations to future brainstorming meetings, the brainstorming sessions are perceived as a chance for engineers to, quote, strut their stuff, unquote. And when invitations to attend are not forthcoming, engineers see this as a sign they should leave the organization. Engineers who acquire these status markers also get paid more than those who do not. Thus, although it may look egalitarian at the surface, IDEO is hierarchical. Quote, equal, unquote, members do not have the equal influence and equal levels of respect from their colleagues or equal access to resources. Similarly, although the chamber orchestra Orpheus does not have a conductor and began with very few hierarchical levels for an orchestra, a different member is now appointed to the, quote, concert master, unquote, for each piece of music. The founder and president has full control over the nature of the program, including what sets of pieces are played and what the program looks like. And there is a, quote, core group comprised of the, quote, principal, unquote, i.e. the highest rank is string, and woodwind players, which makes a number of key group decisions. Orpheus is not alone in the drift it has experienced in becoming more hierarchical over time. Newly formed Silicon Valley companies also tend to become more hierarchical over time. Those do not evolve towards hierarchy are less likely to survive. And then the pages just go on and on with more examples. So as you can see, that hierarchical organizations are inherent in human nature, and they even evolve out of ideologically driven flat organizations. They are more preferable, and they are winning out because of the fact that that's what humans prefer. Now, I'm going to get some people, maybe not anarchist communists or anarcho-syndicalists. I don't know if they support this particular view. I haven't looked into it as much, or I tried to find it and I wasn't able to find anything, but I know that Marxists and Zeitgeisters do tend to think that you can remold the human condition into fitting into these very unhuman organizations. There was a great book called The Blank Slate, The Modern Denial of Human Nature, where he goes into just mounds and mounds of evidence why any of these attempts to reform or remold the human condition is not possible, and gives many historical and scientific data that proves that it's not the case. So anyone who attempts to try to do that, I'm just going to ignore that comment. So anyways, yeah, thanks for watching, and I hope you enjoyed. Oh, yeah, and bring on the red dirt down votes. Let's go. Let's do it.